Chapter 4. Cut and Cover. Travel between Paddington and Farringdon on the Metropolitan line today, and you'd be hard-pushed to find any sign that this 3.5-mile stretch of the tube was the world's first underground railway. When the Metropolitan Railway Company began construction in 1860, without a model for how to build and operate such a railway, they had to forge new ground.
On a cold morning, while the great metropolis was enveloped in gloom, we sallied along the Euston Road. It was barricaded by operations for the Underground Railway, and a very lively and interesting scene presented itself. Part of the street was in the process of excavation, and the subsoil was drawn up in small wagons by means of a snorting steam engine, which emitted a white column of steam into the dark sky. The workmen were variously employed by the glare of torches, some wheeling barrowfuls of bricks and stones along wooden planks spanning the chasm beneath, others mixing the mortar to build the subterranean arch. Some were busy covering the arch with loose soil or gravel and preparing the asphalt over blazing furnaces to overlay it and consummate the work.
Digging up the Euston Road was the most convenient way to build the tunnel, a method known as cut and cover, though it must have been far less convenient for the street traffic. The satirical magazine Punch noted how the omnibuses would now have to improve.
The notification that the rail is to open has produced a most extraordinary phenomenon, and Mr. Punch has heard, but of course allows for exaggeration, that several omnibus cads have spoken civilly to passengers during the past week, and that one, to whom a threepenny piece was tendered by mistake for fourpence, requested the other penny without a single offensive expression. Competition is the true missionary of humanity.
Competition also meant the line was built as cheaply as possible. Rather than suffer the expense of designing new carriages, overground ones were used, with the addition of rubber bags on the roof to supply gas for lighting. But there was the chore of diverting endless water pipes, gas pipes, and sewers under the road. On one unpleasant occasion, a main sewer was breached, filling the tunnel with 3 metres of you-know-what, and earning it the nickname, the sewer. The company also had another problem, because though it might seem a recipe for disaster, the carriages were to be pulled by coal-powered steam locomotives. To get rid of the poisonous gases, ventilation shafts, known as blowholes, were added to the tunnel so drivers could vent the engine fumes as they passed underneath, no doubt frightening anything that happened to be passing overhead. The line opened on the 10th of January, 1863.
There are 5 intermediate stations in addition to those at the termini: Edgware Road, Baker Street, Portland Street, Gower Street and King's Cross, where a junction is affected with the Great Northern Railway. The stations are covered with roofs of glass, extending across the line and platforms, and all are well lighted. The number of passengers has varied from 21,000 to 38,000 daily.
Clearly, the poisonous fumes hadn't put people off, because the Times said,
"A journey from King's Cross to Baker Street is a form of torture which no person would undergo if he could conveniently help it."
The drivers grew beards, supposedly to filter out the thick black soot, although it was reported that asthmatics found the tunnel helped their breathing. This could only have come from the Metropolitan's marketing department. With the line a success, work began extending it to South Kensington. Most of the route fitted conveniently under the streets, but between Paddington and Bayswater, there were people's houses in the way. So numbers 23 and 24 Leinster Gardens, upmarket five-storey mansions in a long Victorian terrace, were pulled down. To conceal the gaping hole, the facades were meticulously rebuilt, even down to the window boxes full of plants, while behind them became a blowhole. It's worth walking along Leinster Gardens to try and find the dummy houses and hear the tube rumbling away behind them. The nearest tube stations are Queensway and Bayswater. The next chapter tells what it was really like on the early tube trains.